Mostly, I'm as a sociologist, I'll be presenting the voice of people, or at least look at what they think about the processes happening in Ukraine right now. And I'm using data of big international project in cooperation of University of St. Gallen. There are some pages. I use maps which are produced by the Ukrainian Research Institute, and I'm part of this team, MAPA project. And I also use a very recent research, and I really want to give some advice if anybody is interested in how people remember about the Revolution of Dignity, which was conducted by the Socioinform, but for this new national complex, Национальный мемориальный комплекс героев Небесной Сотни, Музей Революции и Гидности. So, if you are talking about pre-Euromaidan situation, here we have data showing answers to the questions: would you be willing to erect, or if you have one, to keep in your city monuments to the following listed historical figures? And what we see, we do not have integrated commemorative space, because even Hrushevsky gets as much as 40%, so this is not a majority. And if we look at the both interviews and our surveys, we see that first of all, conflicting places of memory remained rather at the level of peaceful coexistence or segregation of memory, when different groups would go and celebrate or commemorate their stories, but not sharing them with the population of the urbanity. We have a decisive role of local elites who can decide which elements might be rearticulated and which stay, especially if they might be very important for their political campaigns. And we have a striking passive ignorance of the majority of the population. So if you look at the interviews prior to Euromaidan, you see that in majority of cases people hardly could remember any names or any historical events or names them. And if we are talking about the commemoration spaces, they again hardly could name any monuments. For me, a striking example was a very tiny village where a new monument was erected in a triangle between school, shop and the culture club, so, and church as well. So you definitely would go to one of those destinations, but our young respondents tend not to notice at all that this monument is there, and a part of the interview was also a methodology of drawing important objects of village or city, and they also, by drawing, didn't notice that there is something in the middle of this triangle. If we are talking about post-Euromaidan Ukraine, we have this, what Serhii yesterday explained, attempts to sweep any symbolic or many symbolic elements of the Soviet past or Soviet elements of Soviet mythology. And first it was more spontaneous, and later we have this old decommunization law, and this process would be rather controlled from above. We also have rearticulation of past through different types of lead-based initiatives. But I will not be focusing on that part. I will focus more on the search for new commemorative places. Again, first I would claim as a grassroots level, and later with participation or with a protest, it depends on local elite or all Ukrainian elites. If we are talking about Poroshenko's official speeches, what is important for me, we see that he then plays a Soviet historical narrative, especially in connection to the Second World War, and all historical and heroic narratives are linked to Euromaidan and NATO. We see articulation of new holidays, such as, for example, 14th of October, or this 8th, 9th May, which were in Ukrainian calendar, but were celebrated in a different way. And we have three new holidays. Two of them are important for us. Would be Day of Dignity and Freedom and Heavenly 100 Day. So when Poroshenko speaks about the Second World War, first of all, for him the main event would be May 8th. And he also tries to downplay importance of the 9th of May. The Soviet narrative, both chronologically, by including in the last one, his speech just a few days ago, he would talk about Ukrainians participating in armies on all continents of the world, so also going geographically differently. And for him, the shift would be in the meaning that great patriotic war is at all. When he talks about Heavenly 100, he would connect it to the European place of the Ukraine, so we are part of or returning to the European nation. And he also would connect Heavenly 100 situation with Atoll, when unarmed they entered one of the first battles for independence, they did not know that the war will last for several years. What do we have? We have official attempts to canonize this, both narratives, and civil society which is opposing or proposing some other versions. But the question would be, what is the reception of situation with population? And also a very important moment when Euromaidan is used as a moral ideal. We stood on Maidan not for this, Ми стояли на Майдані не за це, which could be applied to many economic and different situations, but also in some cases might be applied to the situation when we need to push others from the scene. If you're talking about commemorations, when we ask about whether people support celebration of May 8th, we see that by 2017, 20% of people claim that they celebrate this, and the only oblast which resisted or had more negative than positive answers would be Kharkiv Oblast. So a new holiday is accepted, but if we go and ask people about renaming how the victory days 9th of May should be named, so not changing anything, just changing names, we already see that approval shrinks to the western and central part of Ukraine. This red circle shows you. And even further, if we ask about would you be willing to switch 3 days from 9th of May to 8th of May, we have only 13% of support which shrinks to Galicia and Volhynia and Transcarpathia. So new holiday would be accepted, but when we step into the situation of rearticulation of the Soviet myths, then we see regionalized picture. We also asked whether people celebrate or commemorate Day of Ukrainian Defenders and Freedom and Dignity Day, and we see that Euromaidan event has between 8% and 6% of participation. But the situation with Day of Ukraine in Defenders, which is linked to ATO mythology, is growing. Its support is growing in numbers and growing in all oblasts of all of the Ukraine. So we can say that in this case, memory about the Euromaidan is rather still regionalized, and memory about the ATO is rather more uniting. This new survey, which I already mentioned, asked whether the Revolution of Dignity should be commemorated. We have 70% of people supporting this. But when we ask who should be responsible, then people say central government or local government. So not us, not activists. In majority of cases, these people there outside. They also ask the question how it should be commemorated, and here we have rather passive forms prevailing over active. So creation of memorial, creation of museum, memorial plaques and monuments devoted to heroes of Heavenly Hundred. People were also asked whether they personally commemorate, and we have only 31% of people supporting this statement. And if we look regionally, that you immediately see that in East and South you would have 8 to 15%. And if they asked about the forms of participation, so the main form would be participation in mass events, like meeting or requiems, or support to the families. And we, when we talk about or ask about proactive position, then we see that then the percent would shrink to from 8 to 5%, like participation in renaming streets, organization of some events or exhibitions, and or participations in creation of new monuments. Frequency of participation, we have again visiting places of memory, museum exhibitions and events, and here you again see that West and Center do have closer to over 50% of different types of participation, and South and East is closer to between 20 and 25%. If we talk about places of memory, to the list you saw above, we added two more positions asking about new monuments. And here we do see that that we have majority of support, both in case of Heavenly Hundred monuments and especially to ATO participants. This map shows you the number of fields as a cemetery is devoted to ATO victims. And but we do still have regionalization, not the similar at the similar level when we talk about the commemorations. But here you see that Kharkiv, Luhansk, and Donetsk Oblast support less this this ideas about the monuments to Heavenly Hundred or ATO soldiers. 65% would support creation of new national memorial or museum. But very interesting, when they were asked what should be in the museum, so we would have a part of heroic or victimhood narrative, but we also have the claims that information about different political groups, and also information about other sides of protest and information about anti-Maidan should be present there. So there is a demand for more balanced narrative. And if we think how people remember, these were two open questions about the emotional perception and definition. And we see here that on emotional level, the main emotion is a fear. And at the level of definition, the prevalent definition is actually coup. When they asked about the top events of revolution of dignity they remembered, again we have this very interesting situation when mostly negative or violent events are remembered, and each side ignores the uncomfortable facts that testifies for the selectivity of memory about the Maidan. So West and Center would rather remember episodes of government's pressure on Maidan, and South and East manifestations of violence from the side of Maidan. But again, if you look at this list, and this list was much longer, in majority of cases we have negative or violent events prevailing. And these are top faces or names which are associated with Revolution of Peace Dignity. And when you look there, you see that majority are actual politicians, not grassroots activists. So for me, all these three slides show us that what is prevailing in society, because again, according to many studies, up to 16% of population participated actively in the events, and rest were following through media. And of course, if you follow media, you have a selectivity effect. So people would select information which fits their opinions. This is one thing. And also media would select, for example, if we are talking about most exotic things to show, so violence would be also important element present there, and politicians because they are recognizable faces. If we are briefly talking about what's happening locally, very interesting thing. First of all, because of this forced or unforced decommunization, we have a situation when in the majority of central, west and south Ukrainian cities you will have a central squares with dismantled monuments which will be used to create a spontaneous places of memory by painting, by bringing pictures, photos, first of Heavenly Hundred, and then this would be followed by ATO victims. The only exclusion is Galicia memoryscapes. Why? Because this Soviet monuments were dismantled long time ago and all these squares are already devoted to some other historical figures. But what we would have, so this memory to Heavenly Hundred is rather physically marginalized in these cities. And also we would have a situation when again in the very center of each city, according to Soviet tradition, we would have Doska Pachota, the memory wall. These Doska Pachotas would be used to as a spontaneous commemoration place, again starting with Heavenly Hundred and then following the ATO. And then all through the country you will see this many types of spontaneous places of remembrance or memory through graffiti, through library expositions, through museum expositions, or in offices, in schools, in offices of different types of NGOs. Gradually new expositions within the Krajewerchesky museums are appearing, and several ATO, the first one was in Dnipro, the ATO museum. Tree planting traditions, but when we go again to the local level, in the contrast to what the government is attempting to replace the Soviet myths with a new one, we see the situation of hybridization, very intensive with different types of connotations. For example, quite often the victims of Second World War will be merged with the new victims, but not only the Second World War. This is Ostroh. The aesthetic is very nationalistic, but what you have lists of all types of Soviet campaigns. Soldiers participated in Africa, Asia, everywhere through the world, and also ATO. You would have, this is a small village in Juran, you would have Soviet soldier, Afghan war soldiers, and ATO soldiers both merge at the cemetery, at the level of monuments, at graffiti level. And also a new plaque to the Soviet period leader appearing in the same symbolic space. This is from Kherson. The down level, this is actually school museum, and you have those typical Soviet veteran pictures with red and black ribbons on them and without any sense of conflict happening there. And of course we have to talk about contra-memories. So this is one of the examples when you have the postman wrapped with a paper. Why? Because the locals constantly express their feelings to both the Ukrainian government and to the decommunization. So local government is tired of spending money cleaning this. So this is a new invention, you just wrap it in a paper and from time to time you change this paper. And you would have, we would register acts of vandalizations of this new grassroots memorial places or spaces all throughout, beginning from the contact zone to Kyiv. So this is not only eastern part of Ukraine with a hot debate inside the counter-memories, but throughout the country. And these are pictures from this Dnipropetrovsk, for example, and Kyiv and other memories. This I will just leave here. These are quotations from our interviews from a new project when we discussed with locals this new memorial spaces. And here we have three types of arguments. First of all, locals doesn't like this situation of questioning of the myth of the Second World War. The other argument is that actually status of this war is very unclear, pretty unclear, so we don't know what we are commemorating. And we also, in many good claim, despite of what we see through our interviews, that in absolute majority of cases, these new places of memory are grassroots level, and this is very new for Ukraine. Grassroots activism, they would claim that everything is imposed from above, from the center. And to finalize, I would say that what is happening in Ukraine, from my perspective as a sociologist, very interesting thing, that from this almost complete ignorance, we have the processes of very active reimagining of past and both and memory scapes in very levels with very different actors. Again, just to give you a joke, late evening, and my neighbor is from Russian-speaking family, who is very far from academia, and she's ringing bell and saying, "Excuse me, I know your husband is a historian. I badly need a book about Bandera and all this Ukrainian history because I'm tired of the discussions with all my friends about the truth, but I need a book about truth." And of course, as historians, for us it's almost impossible to give something which will pretend to have a truth. Yes? We also see that new heroic cult is shaping mostly as a grassroots activism, and again, this is a very new for Ukraine, because typically all the previous periods we would have either central government or local governments just build something, impose something, and nobody is even aware that this monument is already there in their city. But often with either cooperation or opposition with both local administration and government, as well as local public. And it provokes the engagement of local public into democratic procedures of symbolic marking of urban-rural space. For example, many of them claim that they would come to Gromadske Slukhania, they would write petitions, they would come to protest. So this is not only passively accepting something, but participating and trying to voice if you don't like a particular situation. Of course, the question is how successful are those processes, but they are these instruments and these new elements are there. And if we talk about new commemoration practices, we could say that we have emerging stories about Euromaidan and NATO. We have a subordination of other narratives to the past, but also a situation of hybridization with the Soviet narrative. We have official and local historical narratives mutually reinforcing. For example, this new museum on Ato was first created in the Dnipropetrovsk, and then Poroshenko visited it. Yes, more easily accepted than new elements are more easily accepted than recodification of older one practices. And we do have already traces that visiting these new places of memory in some cases are already a new internalized practices. For example, both in East and South, we have during the interviews people saying that yes, when I go pass by, I put some flower, or if I go to the cemetery, I will also stop by these places of commemoration and light a candle. We see that memory of revolution of dignity is more regionalized and often overshadowed by the ad hoc commemorations. And both narratives have limitations because they often exclude those who have a different interpretations of events. I will stop here, and I missed one very important puzzle deliberately. This is IDPs. But I can, during Q&A session, I can also tell about this.